Hello, Concord. Governor Lynch, Susan, thank you both so much for being here, for your service to New Hampshire, your support of the President. Senator Shaheen, thank you. I'd like to thank our nominees for Congress, Annie Custer and Carol Shea Porter, thank you, and I'd like to ask you to vote for them. And I want you to elect Maggie Hassan governor on Tuesday. I hope you will. Folks, the hour is late and the time is short, but on this beautiful day, we can still make a difference in this election. The polls say it's close and it could come down to what you decide. 20 years and 9 months ago, New Hampshire began the chance for me to become president. It's no secret that I never tire of coming here, that I never forget anything that happened here, that I'm still looking for some place I haven't yet been. And it is a very good thing that in the closing days of this campaign, you have the chance to send the president back where he belongs to 4 more years in the White House. The people of New Hampshire were good to me because I just sort of talked to them. I like to talk to people. I like to be in a place that's small enough where people want to look in the eye and size you up and know what you think. I have worked very hard in this campaign. I worked hard in the last one, too. I did 40 events for the president. Hillary did 70. But I want you to know something. I'm much more enthusiastic now than I was then. And maybe because I have done this work, maybe because I know how hard it is, maybe because I know how important words are, but deeds are more important, harder to come by. And I respect a president that goes to work every day, fights through, lives through disappointments, keeps looking for things that work. And these are the reasons that I want you to tell your friends and neighbors who are not here that they should support the president. These are the reasons that I support him. Number one, he has been a faithful commander-in-chief for our national security. He has taken good care of our men and women in uniform. He has ended the war in Iraq. He is drawing down the war in Afghanistan. He has fought the terrorists with vigor, and he has pursued diplomacy with vigor, knowing we live in a complicated world where things change beyond our control, and we need to build more networks of friends and have fewer adversaries. And he's got a very good Secretary of State. And most important to me, he is fully committed to taking care of our men and women in uniform when they come home. Number two, he has done a good job with a difficult hand. The whole election may come down to this. If you listen to what Governor Romney says, it basically is, be very, very disappointed, because not every problem has been solved. Not everyone who wants a job has one. Not everyone's income is rising. Be disappointed. Forget what caused it. Don't pay too much attention to what our solutions are. Just be disappointed. And look at me. I look like a president. And I talk like one. And I'm telling you it's all going to be all right if you elect me. But the whole election may come down to this. I am telling you, I have spent years studying the economy, and I hope I have some credibility with you on what creates jobs, raises incomes, and reduces poverty. I hope I have some credibility with you on balanced budgets. I am telling you, no one who ever served as President of the United States and no one living within the borders of the United States of America could have fixed all the damage that was done from the financial crisis in just 4 years. It is not possible. It could not have been done. So, the test should be, what did the president do? What are the results are? And compared to what? When he became president, don't forget, remember all through 2007 and 2008, you get all the presidential candidates coming here. You had Senator Obama, Senator Clinton, Senator Biden, and several other distinguished Democrats hauling through New Hampshire at a time when incomes were flat, poverty was up, the economy was in trouble. It was bad before the meltdown. Then, just 6 weeks before the election, we have this terrible crash. And the first thing they had to do was to stop it from becoming a depression. To give him credit, President Bush and his administration, John McCain and Barack Obama, both running for president, didn't take the politically easy way out. They saved the financial system from total collapse. And then President Obama continued that work, and he made sure you got paid back. You got all that bank bailout money back, plus interest. You made a profit on that. Then we started the wrong road back. We lost jobs for 15 months after that crash, including the first year and 1 month of the president's term. But in the last 33 months, as we learned yesterday with 172,000 more jobs, we have had 5.5 million private sector jobs. Now, in the 7 years of the previous administration, when they followed the same policies that Governor Romney is recommending, in the 7 years before the crash and after the brief dot-com slowdown, they had 2.6 million jobs. So you got 2.5 years, 5.5 million jobs, 7 years, 2.6 million jobs, the same policies. I'm telling you, compared to what could have happened, Barack Obama has done a good job. Our unemployment rate is 3 points lower than the Eurozone, whose policies have been embraced by the Tea Party Congress and the Republican nominee. With a tough hand, he's done a good job. But you just remember this when you talk to people in the next 2 days. They can say it all they want to. The question should be, are we moving in the right direction, not whether we could have been fully healed. Are we better off than we were 4 years ago? We're losing 800,000 jobs a month. Yeah. Are we moving in the right direction? Yeah. So I'm for President Obama because he's been a good commander-in-chief and he's done a good job. The third reason I'm for him is he has the right philosophy about how to fix the mess we're in. You know, he proved the way he handled this terrible storm, Sandy, in the Northeast, getting off the campaign trail, putting aside politics, working with the Republican governor of New Jersey, the independent mayor of New York City, and the Democratic governors of New York and Connecticut. There is no Republican or Democratic way to deal with the aftermath of a flood, of a storm, of houses burning down, of people losing their livelihoods, and of loved ones losing their lives. You have to begin again, and we have to work together. It was a stunning example of how we're all in this together is a way better philosophy than you're on your own. Now, he proved it in budget negotiations with the Republicans when he offered them right off the bat $1 trillion in budget cuts over the next decade. And he said, now can we make a deal more or less like the Simpson-Bowles deal? And they said no, because we won't put up with one penny of taxes being raised on the wealthiest Americans who got the benefit of the tax cuts in the previous decade and almost all the economic growth. But he tried, and the door is still open. And cooperation works better than conflict. Practical problem solving is better than ideological extremism. And when you keep the door open by re-electing him Tuesday, they will walk through it, and we will begin to have cooperation again. The fourth reason I'm for the president is because of something that President Bush put in a pithy phrase. Now, he got made fun of for it, but he told the truth. He said, the president is the decider in chief. Remember when he said that? But that's true. So let's just check some of the decisions of the two people who wish to be, for the next 4 years, the decider in chief. Barack Obama signed the Lilly Ledbetter Fair Pay Act. A bill that is not just for women, as anybody who ever lived in a house with two working parents knows. Every working husband and father wants the wife and the mother to be at equal pay for equal work for the welfare of the children and the family. When asked in the second debate whether he would have signed it, the president's opponent, who spent all these years telling us how decisive he is, said, well, I thought we were being asked to dance. I mean, how hard is it? He's going to have a lot harder decisions than that to make if he gets to be president. It's just a yes or no answer. It's been on the books for 2 years. How hard is it? Zero answer. Why? Because it might make one of his extremists mad. And so Barack Obama made a decision. His opponent took a dive. I like Barack Obama as the decider-in-chief. Barack Obama decided to fight for funding Planned Parenthood, and his opponent wants to defund it. I agree with Barack Obama. Barack Obama decided that America could not stop making automobiles. And so it was not a bailout. It was a restructuring plan that required give-ups from management, give-ups from labor. The United States loaned money to Chrysler and General Motors. The loans have been paid back with interest. And we invested in their stock, and we'll get that back too. And interestingly enough, all the German and Japanese companies that make cars in America, they were all for that restructuring deal. Why? Because they know we're all in this together. And if General Motors stopped buying our auto parts, then all those auto parts manufacturers would go under, and there'd be nothing to keep the German and the Japanese companies going. They were all there. What happened? We saved 1 million jobs, and now there are 250,000 more people making cars today than there were the day the president pushed that bill through. His opponent decided to oppose it. And now he's trying to figure out how to get out of that in Ohio, where 1 in 8 jobs is tied to the auto industry. I said last night we were in Virginia, he's tied himself in so many knots trying to say he didn't oppose what he clearly opposed that I expect any day he'll be offered a job as the chief contortionist at Cirque du Soleil. But he did. He was against it. Then the administration of the president did another great thing. They reached an agreement with labor, with management, with the environmental groups to double car mileage in the next few years. Double it. Now, put another way, that'll cut your gas bill in half. You just figure how much that's worth. Governor Romney wants to undo it. I couldn't believe it. He wants to undo it. He says, yes, but putting all this new technology, which will create 150,000 new jobs, good jobs paying above average, putting all this technology in place will make the cars more expensive. It will. Maybe they'll cost $1,000 more, maybe $1,500 more. But on average, every car will save $8,000 and lower gasoline costs. You come out way ahead. He'd rather you burn the gasoline than create 150,000 jobs. You save the money, and we can save the planet together. I think Barack Obama made the right decision. Now let's look at the decision Mr. Romney made. When he couldn't get out of the fact that he actually did oppose the automobile plan, he starts saying that President Obama is allowing Jeep to move American jobs to China. Did you see that? I took it personal because I helped Jeep locate that. Well, I helped the state of Ohio get Jeep to locate a plant in Toledo. And I know they're expanding it. They've put $500 million in it. They're going to produce new lines there. I know they're expanding in Michigan. And it's just not true. They made a lot of money so they can reopen a plant they closed down in China to sell Jeeps there because Jeeps are heavy. You can't afford to ship them from here to China. But they're expanding in America. So when Jeep said it wasn't so, they kept making the charge. When Chrysler said it wasn't so, they kept making the charge. Even General Motors said, this is not true. They doubled down on the charge, and then they pointed out that Jeep is owned by Chrysler, is owned by Fiat, you know, or they have. So then the charge became, the president is working with the Italians to move jobs to China. A few days, they're going to come after the Irish, and I'm toast. Now, we're laughing, but it's absurd. Is that the kind of decider-in-chief you want? I don't think so. The guy got caught red-handed saying something that wasn't accurate. But we all make mistakes, and it's not a lie unless you know it's not true when you say it. Now, when I was a kid and I got caught with my hand in a cookie jar, I'd sort of turn red, shrug my shoulders, and take my hand out of the cookie jar. He's grabbing for more cookies. I like Barack Obama as decider-in-chief better. But look, by far more important, and what the president will talk about today, is that his plan for the future is better. And his budget to pay for it and to pay our debt down is better. His plan for the future essentially is to invest in 21st century jobs, in modern infrastructure, in information technology, in clean energy, in manufacturing, in the kind of agriculture that will enable us to feed America, sustain the environment, and feed a growing world. And to educate and empower people to do those jobs, including maintaining and improving the Affordable Care Act, which will give 30 million people, many of them with pre-existing conditions, insurance for the first time next year, and which, much to the chagrin of its opponents, has just given us 2 years with health inflation at 4% or less for the first time in 51 years. We are liberating America. His student loan program will allow students for the first time ever to borrow money at low cost from the federal government and pay it back as a low fixed percentage of income for up to 20 years. This means nobody will ever have to drop out of college again because they're afraid to borrow money or they're afraid they can't pay it back. And he's offered us a budget based on arithmetic, that has $2 in spending cuts for every dollar of revenue increases, all the money to come from people like me. I love saying this. I never had a nickel before I left the White House. Don't forget, In the decade before the crash, 90% of the gains went to the top 10%, 43% to the top 1%, and we also got most of the tax cuts. All we're being asked to do is to kick back in a little money by paying what we paid when I was president, and upper-income people did just fine, but it was the only time in the last 30 years that every quintile, that is the bottom 20%, the 40%, the 60%, the 80%, in percentage terms, your income went up just as much as the top 20%, and we were all growing together. That's what President Obama wants to do. Now, if you look at his opponent, he says, no, we need to do what we did under President Bush. We need to have a big tax cut for high-income people, and we need to cut all these investments and cut all this education and repeal the student loan law. Unbelievable. Make college loans more expensive and increase the dropout rate. That's their proposal. And we need to cut the Medicaid program by a third. Just helps poor kids, most of them in working families. Oh, and it does help Medicare seniors who are living in nursing homes. And it does help middle-class families with children with disabilities, with autistic conditions, and cerebral palsy and developmental disabilities, whose parents could not even work if they were not helped to meet their children's exceptional cost. He wants to cut all that to give me another tax cut. And you say, well, we don't think the numbers add up, because even if you make up for this $5 trillion that you want to cut in taxes, or the $2.5 trillion you want to spend, President Obama doesn't, even if you could do that, you still hadn't reduced the deficit one red cent. So give us a budget. You know, you're the finance guy. And he says, see me about that after the election. See me about that. It's always, see me about that after the election. When I was a kid growing up in Hot Springs, Arkansas, we had a great guy who had a bar. And at noon, he'd quit serving beer on the school day so the kids can come in and have sandwiches. But otherwise, he had a little sign on the bar that said, Wendy's, free beer tomorrow. And he had a deal with the electric company that they never signed the sign off. So I was in there one day, and this guy came in and said, hi, Wendy, I came in yesterday and had a beer. I'd like my free beer now. He said, go out and read the sign. Tomorrow never came. So when a politician tells me, see me about that after the election, it makes me know there's something ugly in there he doesn't want me to see. My president is not afraid for you to see his budget or his plans or his commitments, and they are better. We should elect Barack Obama. Now, I just want to tell you one other thing. This will tell you all you need to know about this election. Governor Romney says, if he is elected, people will be so elated, I'm being serious now, that the economy will produce 12 million jobs in the next 4 years. Now, I am sure it's just a coincidence, or maybe he forgot, because as President Obama has told us, there's this great public health epidemic, this virus sweeping across America, causing a condition known as Romneysia. And the virus is so rampant that anybody's vulnerable to getting a little of it. So maybe just caught a little piece of Romneysia. But what he forgot to tell you is this. Just a few days before that 12 million jobs promise was made, an independent business forecaster, Moody's Analytics, said to all of us that we will get 12 million jobs in the next 4 years if we just don't mess up what the president has already done. Now, because I want us to grow together, not apart, because he's been a good commander-in-chief, a good decider-in-chief, a proven cooperator, because he's got better plans for the future, because you and your children and our country will be better off, I strongly recommend that we reelect the next president of the United States, the current president of the United States, our president, Barack Obama.